The National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated stations present The Pacific Story. This is the story of the Pacific, the drama of the millions of people who live around this greatest sea, where the United States is now committed to a long-term policy of keeping the peace. This is a documentary account of the situation in the Pacific, of the men and events which are today influencing world affairs for generations to come. The Marquesas. Miles east of Indochina, where the French are fighting to maintain their balcony on the Pacific, some 2,000 natives of the Marquesas Islands look on with indifference. They represent an earlier stage of the white man's scramble for power in the Pacific, the white man's blackest page in the Pacific.
A century ago, there were 100,000 and more of us Polynesians here in the Marquesas. Today, there are about 2,500 of us left.
They were a magnificent people.
In beauty of form, they surpassed anything I had ever seen. I saw not a single instance of natural deformity among them. The men in almost every instance were 6 feet tall, and nearly every one of them might have been a sculptor's model.
Under the white man, 98% of the Marquesans have died.
It was not entirely our fault.
It was not entirely.
The Spaniards were in the Marquesas nearly 200 years before us, and they butchered many of the Marquesans.
Just a minute. Who is speaking of what we did in these islands?
I was speaking of the Spaniards.
And you were speaking of me. I discovered the Marquesas. It was I who named them Las Islas Marquesas de Mendoza for the lady of the Spanish Viceroy of Peru.
But that was in 1595.
Yes. And what natives we killed in self-defense.
That was Alvaro Mendana, commander of the fleet of Don García Hurtado de Mendoza, the Spanish Viceroy of Peru. And 180 years after he sailed away, the famous British navigator Captain Cook rediscovered the island.
But the British laid no claim to them. That should go into the record.
Of course.
No one paid any attention to the islands until our captain, Etienne Marchand, came and charted the islands in 1791 and named them the Isles of the Revolution.
Ah, but that same year, I came on Nukuhiva and the seven small islands around it and named them the Washington Islands for the United States.
I beg your pardon?
Captain Ingram is the name. You remember me?
Oh, yes. Yes, I do remember something about that. But the very next year, our Lieutenant Hergest came here, and in 1842, our Admiral de Pitoire took possession of the islands. And in the name of France...
Just a minute. I was here before you, Admiral de Pitoire.
You?
Ivan Krustenstern is my name.
Ivan Krusten... Oh, yes, yes, the Russian Admiral. Yes,
I came here in 1804 and surveyed the entire group. And made an extensive study of the islands.
Yes, yes, so you did.
And we committed no outrages against the natives.
I remember now. You did arrive here before our Admiral de Pitoire.
And so did I, almost 30 years before. And I raised the flag on Nukuhiva and claimed the islands for the United States.
Huh? Oh, to be sure. You are Captain Porter of the U.S. Navy, no?
Yes, my name is Porter.
When Captain Porter came to the Marquesas in 1813, the United States was at war with Britain. In his flagship, the frigate Essex, he attacked British shipping in the Atlantic, captured a number of vessels and a good many prisoners. Then, in need of repairs and supplies, he rounded Cape Horn into the Pacific and headed for the Marquesas.
That's a course for Nukuhiva, Lieutenant.
Yes, sir.
From the information we have, we should be able to moor the entire flotilla in Taiwi Bay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Among the natives on the beach was an Englishman named Wilson.
I just wanted to pay me respects, Captain, sir, and to place me vast knowledge of these islands at your disposal, sir.
Mm-hmm. And what is the temper of the people?
Oh, they're a charming lot, really. Probably the most handsome people in the South Seas, they are. Strong and powerful.
But are they friendly?
Oh, very hospitable, matter of fact, very trusting. Some of them cannibals, you know, that eat each other. Oh, but they've never eaten me. Even though some do say that they're bloodthirsty. There's only one thing, Captain, sir.
Yes?
Yes, there's trouble between the tribes.
Serious trouble?
Oh, yes, sir. The Tiaway tribe. That's the one that's right here around Tiaway Bay. They don't get on well with the Apa tribe on the other side of the ridge at all. There's dozens of tribes here in these islands. So while these people are very friendly...
Captain Porter proceeded cautiously. First, working through Wilson, he sent a party ashore to make friends of the Marquesans.
It's possible we may be here for some time.
Then he engaged the help of the Marquesans in the construction of a fort, and around this established a camp. He brought ashore goats and cattle and pigs. The sly Wilson became the close advisor of Captain Porter.
There'll never be peace in these islands here, Captain Porter, until the differences between the tribes are settled. Now, as I see it, if I may be permitted an observation, sir, as I see it, there are too many chiefs on these islands.
How many are there?
Oh, I presume to guess, sir, but... many tribes, I don't know more. But I do know this, sir. There are more than 100,000 natives in these islands. Maybe as many as 160,000.
Mm-hmm.
Now, take those apples on the other side of the ridge there. They've got a chief that's poison. Troublemaker, he is. Now, if you was to ask me advice, I'd say that we ought to join the Tiaway tribe here around us and go after them apples.
Very soon, the friction between the two tribes burst into flame. And Captain Porter took the side of the Tiaways. The Hoppers were put down. The news of the fighting swept through the islands. Other tribes became involved.
Hands are down! Stop them! All right, Lieutenant! Forward!
Forward, men! After them!
The fighting raged over the mountains and through the beautiful valleys. When it was done, 31 tribes swore allegiance to the United States. And Captain Porter hoisted the American flag over the fort of Nuka Hiva and named the island Madison Island after the President of the United States. Quiet settled over the island, and Captain Porter went about repairing his ships and replenishing his supplies. With his task done and his men rested, Captain Porter called his officers together in his cabin.
It's time to resume operations against the British. You three officers whom I've named will remain here. You will have under your command 20 men. I'm leaving in your charge the 3 captured vessels and 6 prisoners of war. Any questions? Lieutenant?
None, sir.
Very well. We'll get underway at dawn.
The Marquesans came down to the shore and watched the vessels, one by one, put out to sea. The American officers and men stood among them. But Wilson was not there. Wilson was back in the hills.
The white captain and his scoundrels have robbed you of your island. They outraged your women. They brought you disease. They took your breadfruit and bananas and coconuts, your plantains and your yams, and they raised that flag over your island. They've gone to bring more shiploads of men here and make you slaves. Down with the Americans. Kill them. Against the Americans. Follow me, all of you. Follow me. Down with the Americans.
The beaches and the valleys blazed with fury. The fort fell. The American flag was hauled down. Most of the Americans were killed. One lieutenant and a few of the men managed to reach one of the captive ships in the harbor.
Heave!
Battering the decks around them, Lieutenant Gamble and the few American survivors escaped to sea in the captive vessel. They reached Hawaii, but there they were captured by the British, who meantime had also captured Captain Porter and his flagship, the Essex. The United States never recognized Porter's annexation of the Marquesas. The islands became the backwash of the European scum of the South Seas. Adventurers and fortune seekers, traders and seamen, dilettantes and fugitive criminals, missionaries, whalers and beachcombers came to the island of Tarawata and the valley of Batayu. They came to the island of Hiva Oa across the channel. They came to Nukuhiva and Fatuhiva. They commandeered the best locations along the beautiful sandy beaches and in the hills overlooking the shore.
You please. You should see my place. I got the Kanakas to build a place for me. Right back up there in those groves. Right there. Where I have full control of all the coconuts and the breadfruit and the banana trees and the lime trees. That's what I'm after.
Yeah, but have you got any wenches like mine?
I am here to make money first.
That's all you say to think of.
One thing at a time. Dear drinker.
Grog shops and ramshackle trading posts sprang up along the beautiful semicircle of the bay. Bungalows were built in the shadow of the massive rocks. A church and a refectory was built at the edge of the rich verdure, which covered the valleys and extended up into the steep mountains. And while the roistering white men laughed and brawled and dragged Polynesians into the grog shop and sought their women in the settlements and in the valleys and in the hills, the tolling of the church bell became a familiar sound.
The white man's disease, like a searing flame, swept through our islands. And for every white man it killed hundreds of my people.
Look at the outriggers coming in. More of our people from Fatuhiva are coming here to escape the sickness.
But they are bringing the sickness with them.
We must stop them from coming here. We must stop them.
We cannot stop them. And even if we could, they are our brothers. Whaling ship brought tuberculosis. My people had never known any such disease. They cared for the sick white men, and they got it. And never having had such a disease, it spread through them and cut them down without mercy. Other ships brought syphilis and smallpox, and many other strange diseases. And the bell tolled day after day. But the bawling of the white men for control of my people did not stop. That our chief, Iotete, went to your Atmon for help.
Oui. And he gave it gladly, did he not?
Yes. He gave it because he had something in the back of his head.
Admiral de Petit Trois acted quickly, sent an armed force ashore into the valley of Atahu, and established a garrison. He raised the French flag. But when the Marquesans realized the meaning of all this, trouble follows. Among those killed was the French officer, Captain Harry. The French then pursued their conquest with more vigor. The fighting spread to the other islands, to Nukuhiva, to Hiva Oa, to Fatuhiva. The Marquesans fought fiercely with every means they had, even cannibalism. One by one, the islands were subdued by the French.
Yes, all but Hiva Oa. Bloody Hiva Oa.
Invaders, do not retreat! kill the Frenchman. We will never give up. He or we are.
Bloody Eva Oa. It was the last island to fall to you, French.
But to the credit of France, it must be said that we brought law and order to the Marquesas. We set up an administrative offices in Atuono on Hivaua, and there is still a settlement there today. But after all that, there was really little reason for us to stay in the islands.
By the time of the American Civil War, the Marquesas had virtually been abandoned by the French. The whalers no longer put in at the sunny lagoon. Few traders called. Beachcombers who had reveled in its plenty now shuddered at its loneliness and pleaded with shipmasters to take them away. Where the thousands had walked, now there were few or none. The island of Mo'otane was empty and silent and desolate. Fatuhuku was empty.
What are these here?
These burial caves.
You mean people are buried in these caves?
Yes, many.
How many?
Nobody know now, but many, many. No more people, this island.
I see.
At the close of the American Civil War, an American with ideas came to the island, Captain Hart.
This is the most promising island, as I see it. Hiva Oa.
Bloody Hiva Oa.
Second largest island in the group. There's copra here, but hardly enough to justify regular steamship calls. You'd have to depend on tram steamers or trading schooners. But that plateau up there, that's something else. Cotton. Should be able to grow cotton without trying there.
Some cotton grow wild here on Hiva Oa.
Can't help but grow on this island. But up on that plateau, I'll cultivate it. You want to work for me?
No. No work.
Well. You?
No. No work. Plenty eat here.
Yeah, that's the trouble. Breadfruit and bananas and coconuts and mangoes for the picking. How many of you want to work for me?
So, Captain Hart sailed back to the United States and returned with a shipload of Chinese from California. He put in his cotton crops, and while they grew under the supervision of his overseer, he went abroad and returned with still more Chinese. But the Chinese were not satisfied.
We cannot prosper making money for the American.
We are foolish to work in his cotton fields when there is so much to trade here.
Yes, much copra and sugarcane and wild cotton.
Let us stop working for the American and work for our sailors.
Quiet. Did he come now?
Ah, I have a surprise for you, a wonderful luxury. Tonight, when your work is done, I'll give it to you.
Opium. The American gave them opium to try to keep the Chinese working in his fields. But one by one, the Chinese left anyway. Those that did not leave the islands became traders. Then, to induce those of my people who were left to work for him, the American gave them opium, and they sickened and died.
Captain Hart went further abroad, sailed around the Horn up into the Atlantic, returned with Martinique Negroes. They failed. Then he turned to the West. Annamites from Indochina were being brought into the South Seas for labor. He brought in Annamites. The work broke them down, and they died. The cotton fields on the high plateau where the soil was rich and the water plentiful, the cotton fields grew up with undergrowth. The jungle closed in, choked the cotton to death, and reclaimed the land as if no white man had ever scratched it. And Captain Hart sailed away and never came back.
The opium stayed. Some of the few of my people who were left became users of the drug. And you white men permitted it to be used.
Control of opium is a difficult thing. When we came back to the islands, we discouraged its use.
French came back in the 80s.
The history of the Marquesas is, of late years, much confused by the coming and going of the French. At least twice they have seized these islands, and at least once they have deserted them.
That was Robert Louis Stevenson when he visited the Marquesas in 1888. He walked among the Pepes.
The Pepes are found everywhere. These are stone platforms at which the Marquesans built their houses. They are from 20 to 30 feet square, and they stand from 2 to 6 feet high.
Robert Louis Stevenson also saw the Mares, the bigger stone platforms where once stood the houses of the priests. And he saw the great platforms that were the public meeting places, the amphitheaters of the Marquesans.
The Mares, like the thousands of Pepes, are empty.
From the time of Robert Louis Stevenson, the French have remained in the Marquesas.
Yes. And when the war came and France fell to the Nazis, we in the Marquesas denounced the Vichy government and joined the fighting French of General de Gaulle.
When France fell, many of you French here and in the other islands of French Oceania were really for the Vichy government.
Did we not declare for the fighting French government in London?
Only after most of the French civilians here and in the Society Islands and in Tahiti voted for continuing the fight on the side of Great Britain.
By this time, the Marquesans were officially part of French Oceania and were governed from the headquarters at Papeete in Tahiti.
Then most of you French who still were for Vichy were shipped away to French Indochina.
The fighting French government then sent KG Admiral Georges Thierry d'Argentlou to the Pacific Islands. By this time, the Japanese had occupied most of French Indochina and were looking eastward toward French Oceania. If they should gain possession of these islands, they would gain a strategic victory.
Look here at this chart.
Admiral d'Argentlou pointed out the strategic importance of the islands.
Here you see, in these islands, we virtually cut off Samoa from approach from the east. Also, we lie directly across sea transport lanes from Panama and the west coast of the United States to Australia and New Zealand. Regardez, voici. And here you see, should the Panama Canal be damaged, we flunk all sea transport using the Straits of Magellan to Australia and New Zealand.
D'Argentlou organized the resistance on the islands. And the Japanese, angered at this presumptuousness, since the islands were largely defenseless, issued a warning.
The activities of the fugitive friar from France, who was also known as Admiral D'Argentlou, are not lost upon us. And we say to him, Japan will not hesitate for a moment to resort to force to stamp out him and all the Gaulists in the Pacific.
D'Argentlou stood fast. And from this time on, the islands of French Oceania swung into the orbit of the United States, Australia, and New Zealand. Warships and transports, cargo carriers and tankers, vessels of all kinds put into the bays of the islands of the Marquesas in the years of the war. The descendants of the 100,000 or more Polynesians who once lived on Nukuhiva, Hiva'oa, Fatuhiva, and all the other islands of the Marquesas came down to the beaches to see them. But these were no longer all pure Polynesians. Now they were intermixed with Chinese and Indians, Annamites and Negroes. And some of the oldest among them could remember when those other ships had come, bringing white men and trouble.
The fighting never reached our islands during the war, but the islands were nevertheless strategically important. We had had for some years a wireless station at Atuona on Hiva'oa. We had had a subsidiary station at Taiohae on Nukuhiva. With these, we kept in close communication with our headquarters at Papeete in Tahiti. And also, we had always communications with the outside world by schooners and steamers, which called every few weeks.
With enormous problems of reconstruction and rehabilitation at home, France is facing severe tests in her possessions across the sea. At one and the same time, she is struggling to get on her feet and to convert her empire into a solid political unit.
Imperialism! Imperialism!
Fighting in Indochina echoes across the Pacific to the people of the Marquesas, who regard it with indifference.
What meaning can it have to us?
The preamble of the new constitution of France says, France forms with the peoples overseas a union
founded on the equality of rights and duties without distinction of race or religion. And these apply to you, Marquisans, as it applies to all the other peoples in our overseas possessions.
To us, it makes no difference.
Today, the old ones sit on the beautiful, melancholy beaches and look far out across the peaceful sea. Where once the outrigger canoes rode the waves, manned by stout and eager Marquesans, now there is only emptiness. The lovely hills and valleys are forlorn. Such life as the islands know is about the village of Ataona, at the mouth of the most beautiful valley on Hiva Oa, overlooking the Bay of Traders. Here the Marquesans move aimlessly among the few bungalows and the administrative office of the French, or sit on their stone pepes in the shade of their thatched roofs. Sometimes they think they hear voices. Perhaps the voices of their people ringing through the valleys and from the cliffs and mountaintops. Or the voices of white men.
It was I who named these islands. And what natives we killed in self-defense.
I named these islands Washington Islands for
the U.S. I surveyed the islands and made an extensive study of them.
I named this island Madison Island in the name of the United States.
The white captain and his scoundrels have robbed you of your island. Down with the Americans. Kill them.
To the credit of France, we brought law and order to the Marquesas. And we set up offices at Arsenal.
And sometimes they think they hear a bell ringing. But this they know cannot be. For years and years have passed since that bell rang. And like the people whose passing it marked, forever disappeared from these beautiful islands. Listening to The Pacific Story, presented by the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations, to clarify events in the Pacific and to make understandable the cross currents of life in the Pacific Basin. Pacific Story is written and produced by Arnold Marquis. Tonight's production was directed by Andrew C. Love. The music was scored and conducted by Henry Russell. Your narrator was Dave Ormond. In this series of particular interest to servicemen and women are broadcast overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. The program Pacific Story, written and produced by Arnold Marquis and produced this evening by Andrew Love, came to you from Hollywood's Radio City and is heard in Canada through the facilities of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.